What we're going to talk about now, I'm going to elaborate a bit on what Matthias mentioned early on in his last lecture, which is this stochastic series expansion. Is this microphone working?
Yeah.
Canceling out my accent? So the stochastic series expansion, I guess unlike the motivation you guys had for the continuous world line quantum Monte Carlo, isn't based on, you don't start thinking about it starting from the Trotter approximation. You start thinking about it starting from the Taylor expansion of the partition function. Okay, so it's a, like the continuous world line method, it's sort of used throughout the community. It's actually quite quote unquote simple and efficient. Very much like the continuous world line method, you can implement it in a very, in a very small code. A basic SSE code can be 1 to 2,000 lines. And like I said, it's approximation free from the outset. So what I mean by this is, it has no Trotter, no intrinsic Trotter error associated with it. So, the purpose of this lecture isn't to give you guys enough detail and principle to necessarily implement this thing, to sit down and implement it right from the lecture. To do that, I would refer you back to probably this PRE paper that I have in the front of the lecture notes, which really details a lot of the sort of implementation details. Really what I want to do is give you more of an overview. How do we construct the SSE type simulations? And for this kind of a broad spectrum of people here, some of you will go on to be great algorithm developers and really advance the field. Like Thomas Schultes taught us, the algorithmic advancement is more important perhaps than the advancement of a computer power, like raw hardware power. So, really what I want to get across to some of this audience is, what kind of models should you be thinking about? What can you really do with the SSE, right? And what can't you do with it, right? And really the big cannot is, again, the sign problem, just like Matthias talked about. So before I start talking about specific implementation, I just want to note the types of models we can do. Very simple Hamiltonian, so spin. So like Heisenberg models, SU2. SUN. So SUN extensions of Heisenberg models. If you read back in the literature, a lot of which has been pioneered by Sandvig on the SSE method, really a lot of the formalism has been developed in context of either the Heisenberg model or the anisotropic Heisenberg model, this XXZ model, right? So I'll develop some of the updates and so on in this XXZ formalism. You can do higher spins. This could be spin 1/2 or higher. Today I'm mostly talking about spin 1/2. You can do hard and soft core bosons, of course, which is highly related to these things. And with the bosons, you can do chemical potentials, the soft core term. You can do long range interactions between bosons and so on. Chemical potential in the boson language is related to the magnetic field in the XXZ language, right? So one of the advantages of these worm updates, or what we call them in the SSE, the directed loop updates, is they enable you to simulate models with either chemical potential or magnetic field to a high degree of accuracy. Okay, so chemical potentials, you can do long range stuff to a certain extent. For example, dipolar interactions.
Can you cool on?
Fermionic Coulomb interactions. I'm not going to go there. You can do certain, you can do long range interactions in the diagonal part of the Hamiltonian quite easily. So we'll talk more about that. External fields, chemical potentials. Another really nice thing is you can do extended, I guess, kinetic energy type interactions, like ring exchange interactions. So these might be things that are, you know, S dot S IJ S dot S KL. IJKL are four different spins around the Plaquette of various geometries. You can actually do these on triangular, kegame, square lattices, and so on. So, you know, really the idea I want to get across is, you know, you guys, when you start doing this for a living, you'll be using your imagination, and you'll be using the models that, you know, that you want to solve, that you want to get the interesting physics in. And you'll ask yourself the question, you know, can I do this with quantum Monte Carlo? Or you'll also ask you the question, can you do this with, can you solve this model that's got the, you know, topological gauge glass that I predict with quantum Monte Carlo, right? Well, so that's what I want you to get out of this lecture. So what models can I do, right? What basis and operators can I sample? What is a sine problem? What doesn't have a sine problem? That type of thing. So the SSE is quite flexible. And I think you find that you can do a lot of these models that you can imagine. You just have to sort of, I guess, not be scared to implement them, right? So, constructing a quantum Monte Carlo. What's the philosophy behind this thing? Okay, really what you're trying to get at is expectation value of some operator O question.
Coming back to the models, does it mean that, like the ring exchange thing, models, for example, could you do it with a path relative, or is the question of a speed or efficiency?
No, I think anything I tell you that can be done in the SSE can in principle be done in the path integral approach. Am I wrong?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I think, and you know, the formulation of a sine problem is basically the same thing. That's what it boils down to, right? And also some of these methods that I won't talk about based on valence bond bases and so on, which I guess when they were initially being developed, people thought they might have a different type of sine problem. Very likely they all also have the same sine problem. Okay, so the models that you can do, the models that you can do with one, you can do with all of the Monte Carlos, so, as a generalization. So really what we're doing
fermions
is...
Fermions are different.
Pardon?
Fermions are different.
Fermions are different. So determinant QMC is a different beast, so I won't talk about that. So what are we really doing here? We're, again, you know, estimating the sum, if you will, by, you know, summing over all the configurations in some ensemble, where this X is just a label for these configurations. Now, if you flip through my notes, you'll notice I use a different notation than the DS. I use W for weights and P for probabilities, which is the opposite of what he did. So that's just to keep you guys on your toes. And again, so this thing is approximated by important sampling of a Markov chain, right? So you're in some configuration space, which X is running over, and you're sampling transitions from X to Y to Z, whatever, along this Markov chain, right? So the question you have to ask is, you know, there's several questions. So like the first one is, what are your configurations, right? So in a very abstract way, of course, as you learned this morning, they're not just Ising spins up and down. They're a basis state, if you will, and that basis state is propagated by a world line. So you know that the configurations really are this D plus one dimensional simulation cell. You need to know what are your configuration updates. So in the SSE, there's not one update, there's several updates. Okay, so you have local updates for diagonal operators. And in analogy to the worm algorithm, you have loop updates, which sample both off-diagonal and diagonal operators. You have more complicated cluster updates when you're doing ring exchange Hamiltonians and so on. And you can also have some types of thermal updates that you do at high temperature. Okay, so the updates themselves are like also a product of your imagination, right? You have to convince yourself at some point that you need a certain type of update to keep your simulation ergodic, right? And really, you know, the adding all these different updates which some of them have to be tailor-made for the specific problem, are really in a sense to get over these ergodicity issues. So you have to accept and reject the update based on the metropolis. So you have to figure out the metropolis. What do you call them? Acceptance probabilities. You go from a configuration X to Y. So you have to derive those based on, in this case, it's going to be the partition function, right? And then you have to, once you have all that figured out, you still have to implement measurements, right? So implementing measurements, of course, you have all your standard measurements like energy, specific heat, and so on. But what you'll find is if you know sort of the nitty-gritty of the code, if you really develop one of these things for a specific model, then you'll have the advantage that you can, again, use your imagination and think of, you know, what different things might we be able to measure in these types of quantum Monte Carlo. Okay, so the first thing we're going to work on is, constructing, looking at what a configuration is, and constructing some of the updates. Okay, so for us, our configurations. They consist really of two different things. One is a basis state. Okay. So we're going to be diagonaling some basis. And so very similar to what we saw in the other case, this could be the SZ component of a spin 1/2, right, which is very intuitively similar to what we did with the 2D Ising model. It could be boson number, boson density. But, depending on what you're looking for and what kind of model you have, what the Hamiltonian looks like, you can have other bases. And one that's popular these days is this valence bond basis. So valence bond. So you can have a basis which is simply a singlet. Okay, and you can construct a Monte Carlo. You can construct the configurations, which is the basis state, the operator list, which I'll talk about, and all the updates, acceptance probabilities, and measurements in one of these sort of non-trivial valence bond bases, which is gives you some advantages and disadvantages.
Could you just say something about why you use valence bond versus SC or vice versa?
So typically, a valence bond basis is used in a zero temperature projector method. Okay, so we're not going to talk about apparently zero temperature projector QMCs, like diffusion QMCs in this school. Maybe we are, but not this week when I'm here. But the valence bond gives you some advantages in simplicity of updates, essentially, in these zero temperature methods. So these are acting with H to a high power on some trial wave function, projects out the ground state energy. Oops. And the ground state wave function in the limit of large n. Okay. So the Monte Carlo based on this projector method is different than the quantum Monte Carlo that we have based on the partition function. And the valence bond basis gives you some advantage in updates and stuff. Okay? So there, you have a comment?
It can be shown that the valence bond basis. It's the same method as the cluster update. So the gap connections chance we saw before, they are just those valence bonds. That's
cool.
The cluster connection here, yeah, that's is certainly in the review by the errors back in O2.
Okay. So the loop algorithm.
The loop algorithm is
that
the response
page. I mean that review of errors.
Yes. Yes. That already has that.
Good.
In the hidden.
Yeah, that's a good review. I encourage you guys to read that. Right. It's the average. Was it 2002?
Yes, 2002.
Yeah. I think it's just called the loop algorithm.
The loop algorithm. Yeah.
So there's some local experts who do the valence bond basis QMC here, if you want to talk to them. So Ann, Callan's one. Everyone look back at it there. Hi, Ann. So she can, you know, she can tell you a little bit about this. I encourage you to take advantage of her and your time here. That came out wrong. Take advantage of her expertise. All right, good times. So this is only the basis state, okay? It's only one part of your configuration. The second part of your configuration is like the world lines. And for us, it's the world lines, or in the SSE formalism, it's what we call an operator list. So it's all the operators that propagate your basis as you run through this trace, okay? So what this trace is in the finite T, as the Theus rule. Okay, so sum over elements of the basis state, which I'm calling alpha. E is minus beta. Okay, so as pointed out, this is a quantum operator, right? It's not your internal energy in the simple way that it is in the classical sense. And so you need some way of doing, if you will, an expansion, right? And the expansion in the world line method is really a time expansion, if you will. In the SSE, it's a Taylor series expansion. So this is where the SSE comes in. Stochastic series expansion, against like an impossible name to remember. Sandvig, simple and efficient, maybe? Rename it, since he's not here, I can tease him. So in the SSE, really what you're doing is Taylor series, which you write formally as this sum, right? And H, the operator, raised to power n. Right? So what you're doing is you're writing this power as a product of n operators. And in between each one of those operators, you're inserting a resolution of the identity. And that resolution of the identity, again, is in your basis that you've chosen, okay, which we'll talk about. And the idea, or the picture behind it, is that you're really propagating with the operator. With the operator list, those basis states. Okay, so in some alpha, we have h dot h dot h n times, and in between each one, we insert a resolution of the identity, and we absorb that sum in the resolution identity, the sum over the state alpha, into a sum here, which we turn into a sum over a set of basis states. So it's really just a notational thing, right? So then all these elements of this set we write like this. Alpha n minus 1 h alpha n. And as pointed out, this trace, in order to have a non-zero contribution to the trace, you really need to have this last ket, which I don't know if you can see, alpha n equal to alpha naught. Okay, so it's by the periodicity of the trace. So that periodicity is a really important consequence, as you saw, when you're doing updates of off-diagonal operators, okay? Which means when your world lines start having kinks in them, you always have to have that kink move back, move the particle back to its original place in the basis, if you will, before you reach that top boundary.
Does it have any equivalence to when you do it in the quarter decomposition?
There's a formal...
You also need to count down permutations between world lines. There's something equivalent here, or you don't need to care about it?
I'm not sure what you mean, permutations and world lines.
And
you mean when you're doing the sampling?
Yeah, what you do when you have a passing to go, you can close the loop on itself or on its neighboring particle. It has something here? Or it's
so I'll go through the, maybe when I go through the loop update, if that question's not answered, we can show you again. I'll show you what the loop updates look like for updating the world lines in this case, okay? Unless you have a quick response with this one. Well, I erase this.
You have to be able to do the thing. Did I present the updates? The ergodic and local updates don't do that. So you need some global cluster updates or the cutting word lines, and that's what.
No, for, let's say for you, where you write it alpha n equals alpha 0 for a word line, that can be.
Alpha n equals alpha 0, you don't care how it's connected. It's the same state.
Okay.
You don't care how that connects. So that's in the summary.
Okay, so we're about the board. It takes a while. Erase and dry.
So the particles are not distinguishable if it's bosons. Okay. The Boltzmann-ons, then you have to connect the and that will be harder with non-double updates. But most particles are bosons, so the fermions and so it's okay.
Okay, so then,
yeah. I had some question about, you know, choice of bases. So, I would think, okay, so you're going to have to make a choice of what bases you work with.
Right.
So, it seems like you can do a clever thing where, well, like very much like you do in the path interval, where you choose a basis that diagonalizes some part of the Hamiltonian, so you don't completely expand.
Mm-hmm.
You sort of do a mix where, you know, you're also expanding in one in beta, but you're also expanding in somehow strength of the or strength of some piece of the Hamiltonian.
Right, so what happens here is, how do you choose your basis? You have to split your Hamiltonian up accordingly into the diagonal part, right, the part that's diagonal your basis, and then the off-diagonal part. And the consequences in the SSE is the updates, the way to the sample those operators are quite different. So one of them is very simple, the update for the diagonal case, and one of them is quite a bit more complicated, and that's one of these looper cluster updates. And that affects most seriously the sampling the off-diagonal operator.
So another question concerning the choice of the base. So you said you can also do SQL symmetric models? So if I imagine to simulate an SQL symmetric model, I think I would choose a base consisting of SQL valence one rather than SQL two valence one, right?
I was only going to talk about product bases in this case. So you can, yes, you can choose a different valence. You would choose a different valence bond if you're doing the higher symmetry spins, if you will, right? But okay, I'm sort of going to keep it simple because, I mean, I think to describe the updates in these other cases is really not something that we can do in a certain remaining time. So I'm really just going to talk about product bases, which is in our case going to be SZ spins. Or you can do SX. You know, your diagonalization, the quantization axis of your spins affects what you can measure in some sense too. But we'll do the simple case, which is SZ or boson number. Okay. So we can talk more about these other interesting bases after. The idea is that your Hamiltonian also is this huge big matrix thing, right? But what I wrote over here, like just have an H, just kind of a placeholder, is really just a formal way of saying that I'm going to sample terms in the Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian itself has to be broken up in the SSE. And this is another non-trivial thing which you can sort of change depending on what you're trying to measure and how your simulation performs. So typically this B is bonds. When we have operators that are bond operators, right? So like S dot S or something like that. Even if you have bond operators, you can choose bigger plaquettes, if you will. B could be a plaquette, which could be some extended thing, square, you're going to be triangular, and so on. And there's some advantages and disadvantages to how you break up the Hamiltonian. So what you're doing is, you know, you're deciding how you break it up, and you're inserting these HB into each one of these, if you want to call them time slices, and sampling over different HBs. So you're also sampling, in a way, the sum associated with how the Hamiltonian is broken up. So we're going to stick with the bond picture. And I'll do an SZ basis, the XXZ model. And because spins look funny on the board, I'm going to do X for up and O for down, which is basically the same basis as hardcore bosons in the XXZ model. So if I have a one-dimensional spin system, I start out a simulation, I can start constructing the simulation by writing out the basis. So you imagine these are all my spins, and I have a bunch of bonds between them. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bonds. And now my Hamiltonian is broken up into bond operators. And what this partition function is telling me is that I'm propagating this list in this expansion direction with a bond operator in between each time slice. Okay, so I can have an operator there. And if this operator is a diagonal operator, I don't flip any spins on the basis. My alpha 1. And if I have an operator which is an off-diagonal operator, give it a different color or something, then I'll flip the spin sort of very schematically from down up to up down. Okay, so now you're seeing how this maps to a whirl line in some sense. So when the spin is up or when the particle is there, you can see that it has some sort of path in the expansion direction, which is the, you know, in this case, which is the Taylor expansion direction. And what you'll notice is that this basis state now, which is alpha 2, is not equal to alpha naught. And so, depending on how many slices I have here, you know, I really want, in order to get a contribution to the partition function, I'm going to have another off-diagonal operator at to flip these basis spins back to the original alpha naught configuration, or else the contribution of the partition function will be zero.
I'm being slow here. So how do you deal with superpositions in this language? I mean, if it's alpha 1 plus,
you only sample product bases. It's the same as the whirl line method. You're only sampling some of these product bases, right? You're sampling the basis.
I don't know what I sampled. I've never done that.
Yeah, you're sampling the basis. I mean, we're building it up from sort of intuition here, right? This isn't the full breakup of the problem yet. You're just sampling operators, which affect your basis, and you're sampling the basis itself, and it's all tied together. The sampling of the basis is done by the operators. So you can see it says, you know, the dynamics, if you will, of the Monte Carlo is somehow intrinsic to the operators, right? And so, you know, maybe you're asking, can the ground state you're looking for be represented in this breakup, okay? Or you might be asking, can you do the measurement that you want to do? It's sort of doing this breakup, right? So those are maybe non-trivial questions. Especially, what can you measure, right? What can you measure if this is your basis state in your configuration? Okay, so we sample, again, the operators in the list, and we sample the bonds which propagate this thing, okay? And the trick in the SSE is to, you know, cut off somehow the number of Hamiltonian, I guess, propagators that you have in this list, okay? So it's called the cutoff. So you want to cut off the maximum number. If you want to call them time, then it's time slices that you need to store in the computer, right? Because really what I'm going to tell you is you want to sample a number of these operators, so there should be n operators for every term of that expansion there. And then that's go to infinity, but you can only represent a finite number of these operators in your computer, right? So you want to cut off the maximum number of time slices that you store. And the reason you can do this is because the probability that, if you will, an expansion order n contributes to the partition function at a fixed beta, basically a fixed beta, it has some distribution in n. Okay. So this is like a consequence of the factorial that Matthias talked about on the bottom of the Taylor expansion there. It cuts off, if you will, in some sense, the n which contributed to the partition function. You can also see intrinsically if you build a type of code like this and you sample for, like again, a fixed beta, the number of operators which you tend to be sampling. So the cutoff means that we only have an expansion direction in the computer that's some m greater than n max. All right, and that cutoff changes depending on everything that's going into your simulation. You know, temperature, parameters, and so on. So most drastically, you know, if you have a very high temperature, as you imagine, you get a tighter distribution. The expansion direction, which is analogous to your imaginary time direction, doesn't have to be as large, right? And if you have a very low temperature, then your distribution gets smeared out, you know, way up here somewhere. And you have to keep increasing this cutoff, sort of as you lower the temperature of your simulation. Okay, so this is something you build into sort of your sampling.
Time slices in this case always means order of which you are considering the expansion of the partition.
So I'm going to call it time slice, which it isn't exactly. The order of this expansion here. Okay, but this introduces a complication of that because it's not just n, fluctuating n number of operators. You have a fixed number, right? So you have a fixed number of steps in this expansion. But you have to have some of these slices here without an operator in them, right? So m is always going to be bigger than n. So I have this big expansion direction m. Okay. So let me draw it. This will get tedious fast. Say for some reason I'm sampling n equals two operators. Okay, so I can have an operator here and an operator here. The m of my simulation is still going to be the amount of operators I am allowed to somehow have. So it'll be 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So the idea is you fix that m and you allow n to fluctuate. And that simplifies every aspect of basically coding and sampling in the SSE. So what's the problem when you do that? Like what's the problem with your partition function then?
Can you get non-analytic free energy with finite number, with truncation of series at some point? I mean, if you want to describe a free transition, then you need non-analyticity in free energy. Is it a problem or not?
No.
There's
no error associated with the cutoff. It's always adjusted to be bigger than the maximum. You know, this is an integer somehow that you're sampling, right? And in every case, you can just adjust this m to be bigger than the maximum integer that you're looking at. Okay, so the trade-off is, which is really built into the formalism, is that you're always at a finite temperature, right? So you can never go to an infinite temperature here where this distribution would spread out so big that you can never somehow handle the sampling of the n. So that's what I would say the trade-off is. You're always going to be at finite temperature with this type of Monte Carlo.
If you're dealing also with a finite system, the partition function would always be analytic, right? Anyway.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the problem with the partition function in this case is if you're sampling, again, this is sort of a very general overview of what's going on, right? I haven't showed you how to do the sampling yet. But if you're sampling this number of operators in a sort of adjusted simulation cell, it's not exactly the same as sampling this partition function here. Because some of these operators are null operators or identity operators, identity bond operators, which don't contribute in any sense to this actual partition function. So the partition function has to be modified with this combinatorial factor. Okay, so really what's going on here is you're padding, right? M minus N time slices, if you will. Okay, with null or identity operators. Okay, and if this is the sort of physical, the two physical operators that you're sampling, of course, there's many different ways to do to pad this size M simulation cell with these null operators, right? So this is combinatorial factor that I have in the notes. Certainly what you're doing is you're choosing M minus N out of M, or equivalently M choose N, right? Which is N factorial, M minus N factorial. So what I'm saying is if you do the sampling in this modified simulation cell, okay, you'll also be sampling this number of additional contributions to, you know, this partition function that you're trying to calculate, right? So that has to be compensated for in the expression for the partition function. So this is really the if you will, the consequence of doing this cutoff. Okay, so then the modified partition function for the cutoff. So I'm going to consolidate some of this notation. So it's alpha. So I'm sampling basis states again. I'm sampling, I'll call it a list of bond operators. And my minus beta, the n. And I have to divide by this number, so I get n minus n factorial over m factorial now. Right? And then I have this expansion. So I'll just call it HB naught or HB1 or whatever you want. So this is N minus 1, or M minus 1, HB alpha M. So I do this expansion up to M, then I have to include null operators. Again, just these identity operators here. Okay, so really all I've done is constructed an idea for what the basis state is and what we're sampling. So this is the configuration, right? This is the X. This is like the spins of the Ising model. And I have the partition function which describes it, you know, which returns to me the physics which I'm looking for in the problem. And now the problem boils down to basically just, calculating or figuring out how we do the different updates of the configurations. So that's what I'm going to talk about now.
So how would you know N max, like a priori?
You don't. That has to be adjusted during equilibration time. Okay, so just like you guys do equilibration when you're doing the ALPS codes, right? All these, M, if you will, the cutoff has to be adjusted. Actually, it has to be adjusted throughout, because you can always have statistical fluctuations with push the N that you've sampled up to something, sort of anomalously large, right? So it's just adjusted during the simulation. So what I do is I just, I increase M all the time when I'm doing the equilibration, and I never bring it back down again, right? So M equilibrates, if you will, to some large value. It stays large for the whole simulation.
So cutting out the series, I'm still a little bit unclear. If the temperature is below your characteristic energy scale in the problem, in what way, how does it justify that the series is convergent? Or is there any reasonable expectation from a finite series to get? In a sense, H over beta H is wrong.
So what's the sort of like theoretical justification for the distribution converging, you mean, or?
Nothing, necessarily the rigorous answer, but just
right.
How does it work out that if you're looking at low temperature phenomenon?
Well, Well, there is just going to be some practical lowest temperature you can go to, essentially, always, right?
Okay.
I mean, so the sampling gets less and less efficient as you go to lower and lower temperatures because your sort of simulation cell gets bigger and bigger. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of the trade-off. I mean, really what this is implying is that the simulation efficiency scales linear in beta, right? Because the sampling that you have to do is in this sort of expansion direction also. So just like doing a classical Monte Carlo, you're somehow limited in system size you can do practically because of the scaling is n. And in this case, you have an additional scaling, even n scaling, but you also have a beta scaling, right? So there's a practical lower limit on the temperature you can go because of that. But you know, linear and beta scaling isn't actually bad for quantum Monte Carlo, right? This is basically the best you can do. S is linear in n. So
you're just saying like the lower temperature, you want to go to lower temperature, you mean it's like studying larger systems.
Yeah, it's a larger system. This is your system now, right? This is your configuration. It's d plus one dimensions. So going to lower temperature is just empirically this expansion direction gets much larger.
But in principle those factorials will kill any beta h ratio, right?
Yeah.
Eventually.
But you probably don't have to say, you know, that you're probably sampling the first 5,000 orders in a typical expansion, not the first 5.
Oh, yeah. Right. It's a big number. Okay, so we want to at least look briefly at what are the updates we're doing, right? And the first one that I have in the notes here is a so-called dying object. Okay, so this is a consequence of how you chose your basis, right? You have to now split your Hamiltonian into operators which are diagonal and off-diagonal in the basis. And this is the update that fluctuates n, or samples n. Okay, the number n. As I wrote in there, insert and remove operators, okay? So you have to split your Hamiltonian, your bond terms, into diagonal and off-diagonal parts. So call 1b and 2b, okay, symbolically. And in general, if you have a more complicated Hamiltonian, like a ring exchange Hamiltonian, or a one with an extended kinetic energy term, or a long-range diagonal interaction, you might have to have different types of these, you know, quote-unquote types of these bond operators in practice. But we'll do this one because it follows straightforwardly from the XXZ model. Okay, so somehow I have to start introducing some concreteness into this before it gets out of control. And so the model that we'll be talking about is the term with the diagonal operator here. So we're choosing the SZ spins as the basis. And then raising and lowering operators for a bond IJ here. And then therefore, the diagonal part is just delta SZI SZJ, where I and J are the two elements of the two members somehow of that bond B, right? So in the SSE, in this partition function, okay, we're going to construct a weight proportional to this partition function. That's what we're doing. The first thing I wrote, right? We're sampling, we're important sampling according to configurations that are chose according to the weight, the physical weight that you're interested in. So that weight is proportional to this prefactor here, which contains the statistical part, and it's also proportional to each one of the matrix elements, okay? And what we're doing is typically taking a ratio of these weights. So to write in the notation of weight for a given, you know, alpha that you've been sampling and a given list of these bonds, HV, right? So that's exactly what we have up there. Minus beta the N, minus N factorial. N factorial, as I have it in the notes, it's just this product of what we're calling matrix elements, which are just alpha p, h bond, alpha p plus 1. Okay, so I'm going from p to, oh, I'm going to I might have messed up between base 1 and base 0 here. Okay, so each one of these matrix elements basically has to be calculated individually in order to do this diagonal update. And they're very simple for the XXZ model in the SZ basis. Okay, so I have all the notes there. They're essentially just the matrix elements of each bond with the two spins that make up the bond, right? The two SC spins. Okay, just bear with me while I erase this. Okay, so I'll write all these weights at the top here. So each one of these can occur in this expansion, right? So this is the diagonal part of the Hamiltonian. You know, it's a matrix element associated with these two spins are just the local part of this basis, which is affected by the bond operator, right? And so this one's delta by 4, right? Down, down is the same thing. And then up, up, and down, up, down, down, up. You just pick up a minus sign. Okay, and this minus sign is important, because it's sort of the first manifestation that you have of what you can think of as being the sine problem. Okay? So where does that come from? Well, we have the weights now, okay? So we know somehow the weight of a configuration. We can calculate every part of it because we know all the matrix elements. And as we know from the Metropolis condition, which Matthias had in his first lecture, you have to propose a change. So that proposal has a rate. So to use the same notation as him, A, x to y. And then you have to accept that proposal. Accept it with a probability. So this is my acceptance probability. I'm going between a configuration x and y, and it's the minimum, right, of 1. Then it's a rate y to x w y over rate x to y times w x. In that WX, that's just shorthand for the weight, which I have right there. Okay, so what's the transition rates? Well, we have to decide what we're doing. Okay? So in the diagonal update, we have two basic processes which we do. One is to insert the diagonal operator, okay, in this thing that I just wish I didn't erase. You can imagine inserting a diagonal operator into one of the blank, if you will, time slices, or removing a diagonal operator from a time slice where it exists. Okay? So we take a subsection of my basis, and I can imagine stepping through this list in the expansion direction and looking at each time a diagonal operator occurs, and trying to remove that thing with some probability, okay, which I'm going to try to calculate here. And then in the next step, I look at this blank time slice, and I want to insert a diagonal operator with another probability. So there's a transition rate associated with each of those different proposed moves, right? So if you insert an operator, so I'm going from n in my expansion to n plus 1. The rate that that can occur with is, okay, so it's just like we did the Ising model. The rate of change of flipping a spin, of the proposal flipping a spin, is 1 over n, 1 over the number of lattice sites. In this case, it's 1 over nb, where nb is the number of bonds. Okay? So you have to pick at random, if you will, which one of these bonds you're going to insert the bond operator on.
Do you not include the bonds that already have operators there? I mean, you can't insert another operator on top of the...
Right, there's only one operator per time slice, right, so that's important. So if the way you do this update is you step through the imaginary time thing, it's like you're sweeping through your system in the expansion direction, and if you encounter a blank space, then you can insert a random bond operator. But if you encounter this, then the update that you're trying to do is to remove this thing. So this is how you fluctuate an n, right? So when you're adding and removing n operators, you're fluctuating that number, which is sampling, the order of the expansion. So what's the rate for removing? If there's only one per time slice. So what's the n, e, so n going to n minus 1. There's only one way to do it, right? So it has to be 1. Okay, so the rates are uneven. Unlike the Ising model, the 2D Ising model, where the rate was the same, and that N, B, or whatever you want to call it, canceled when you did the acceptance. In this case, the rates are different, okay? So NB, which is the number of bonds, is going to occur in the acceptance probability. Okay, and that probability P is what I've written on page 6 there in the notes. And the way you derive that is by now taking the ratio of weights. Okay? So if I'm doing an update of the first type, n to n plus 1. Okay, so I have the rate. N plus 1 to n here, okay, over the other rate, right? And then I have the ratio of the two weights. So what's going on in the weight here is my weight on top is going to have n plus 1, and all the other operator contributions to this expansion cancel out, except for the one that you're changing, okay? So you get these factors which depend on n in front. So you have n plus 1 from the beta there over minus beta to the n. Okay, you have n minus n plus 1 over n minus n factorial. You have the matrix element, the uncancelled matrix element, right, which in this case you're adding, so it's in whatever time slice it occurs in, there's a diagonal bond operator there. And then you have to have the ratio of those two proposal rates, okay, which is NB. Okay, so that's the SSE probability to accept this move where you insert an operator in a blank time slice. Okay. Question?
About fixing n, are you like truncating the Hilbert space?
Mm-hmm. No. Well, you're only sampling the Hilbert space anyway. Okay.
So you're only sampling the part that's in interest.
It's like you're important sampling the Hilbert space, right? So that's built into this whole idea. The idea of important sampling is you're interested in the part of the Hilbert space weighted by the partition function somewhere, right? So you walk through the Hilbert space according to this important sampling. So that's one way to look at it. So it's important because you don't actually have the operator, you don't have, you know, the density matrix, if you will. You don't have it fully stored in the sense that you do in ED or DMRG or something like that. So you don't have access to the same information. Right? You're really only doing a sampling of the wave function. Okay, so the opposite probability is just the opposite, you know, you put the weight for n minus 1 on top and the weight for n on the bottom. Okay, so that's the probability for, so this one's for adding an operator. And for removing this operator when you encounter it, that's n going to n minus 1. Okay, so you have a configuration and you have an update. And all you had to do was use, you know, some trick of expanding the partition function and use what we already know from our knowledge of Monte Carlo to construct an update and construct a probability associated with it. So that's called a diagonal update. So the thing to notice is that these weights can be negative if you're not careful, right? So as Matthias pointed out, well, in this case, you get an uncancelled, so let me write this one down here. You can get an uncancelled minus sign, right, associated with this beta that doesn't cancel. And you have that thing multiplied by this matrix element, which is, if we look over here, can either have a minus sign or it cannot have a minus sign, right? So the problem is in this case, when you don't have a minus sign, then the minus sign associated with, you know, this Taylor expansion, if you will, it becomes uncancelled, okay? So you can see how you can get negative weights if you're not careful here. And if you have negative weights, then you're not doing Monte Carlo, you're not doing statistics anymore, right? I don't know what you're doing, it's black magic or something. So you have to have positive weights, right? So a restriction on the Hamiltonian could be that these things always have to be negative, okay? Or because, you know, depending on what basis we're working in, you know, the diagonal operators, you can conveniently add a constant to the Hamiltonian that, in this case, makes all the weights in this representation negative. So every contribution will be positive here. And then at the end of your simulation, you just minus this constant off, okay? So these constant contributions affect the diagonal operators. And this is how you get rid of the sign problem in this simple case. So it comes from the uncancelled minus is here. And so the trick is to add or subtract, however it works, a large constant here in Hamiltonian. And I have one in the notes, which is, you know, minus delta by 4 per bond. Okay? And that'll give your matrix elements there the value of either 0 or minus delta by 2. And you'll always have either 0 or negative weights.
So what you told over there, condition probability, is that actually what appears in that fraction in the metropolis thing? Because it's greater than 1.
This has to be the minimum of this or 1, right? Sorry. Oh yeah, I don't have that in my notes, but it has to be the minimum of that thing or 1. It's the acceptance probability. Okay, so that's only one type of update. And what aren't you sampling when you do this? Well, you're not sampling any off-diagonal operators, right? So really, the whole construction of this thing is such that you're sampling, you know, the number n, which is done by adding and removing only diagonal operators. So the drawback if you just do this is that you won't be simulating the Hamiltonian that you want, and you'll get the wrong answer, which is fairly serious. So that's why I have them another update. Right, and that other update is essentially the off-diagonal update, the loop or cluster move that Matthias talked about. And in the SSE, its manifestation is such that we usually start with a diagonal update. Okay, so imagine I keep going in my list here. So I have all these diagonal operators now on my list. And what I do is instead of inserting or removing off-diagonal operators, which causes a problem, right? Because if I insert an off-diagonal operator here, I actually flip this basis state, right? I have to make sure I insert some higher point in the list, another off-diagonal operator, so I got alpha naught here and alpha naught here. Right, so we don't do that, what we do actually is we try to change diagonal operators to off-diagonal operators and vice versa. Okay, and why do we do that? Well, it's just something that works, right? Like these updates, again, are whatever your imagination can allow that satisfy detail balance, right? So in this sense, the most efficient update that you can do that always gives you a non-zero contribution to your partition function involves, you know, taking, in the simplest case, pairs of operators, switching them to off-diagonal operators, okay, which I can make pink. And what this off-diagonal operator does is flip this, these two basis states here and flip them back again, right? X0 and then back to 0x. Okay, so we have diagonal and off-diagonal operators. And the question is, how do you do that practically?
Do you have a complex number problem instead of sine problem? And
no, we shouldn't.
You don't?
No.
Why?
Because there's no complex number in the weight.
In where?
In the weight. In the weight of the operator.
Sorry, I was under the impression that matrix elements, that was matrix elements, and they can be complex.
Right, so in this case, in the XXZ model, the matrix element associated with this thing, up, down, H2B, right, down, up, is minus a half, the way I just wrote it when I just erased it there, right? So again, your weights have to be positive, definite, and real in order to do any Monte Carlo, right?
So you say it's not restrictive in real life? So your Hamiltonians are all symmetric in real life?
Yeah, well, yes. So if you're going to get complex matrix elements, you're going to have to find a way to get rid of that complex number, or else you're not going to be able to use Metropolis on it, right?
Okay.
So again, that's the condition with which we build these. That's the restriction inherent in the QMC.
Can you just add or subtract the complex number then?
If it's diagonal? But what if it's not diagonal?
No, the condition matrices are real when they're diagonal.
Okay. So, question?
In each time step, we don't need just carry out a diagonal operator or just off-diagonal operator and a diagonal operator simultaneously?
Nope, you do one diagonal update, so you sweep through it, and you sample these diagonal operators. Then you do another update, and the second update is this one which is either called, so this is update two. This is operator loop updates. So it's like if you do a bunch of single spin flips, and then you do a cluster move in the 2D Ising model. In this case, you do some local diagonal update, step one. And then as a second step, we gotta sample in some way these off-diagonal operators. Okay, so that's what I'm getting at. So the thing that I just did where I switched diagonal to off-diagonal operators in some sort of pair like this, that's sort of the equivalent of a local update for the off-diagonal operators. Okay, so without loops, really what you have is local updates. And the problem with local updates, as Matthias pointed out, is they don't sample, okay, for number one, they're inefficient, and they don't sample things that you need, like different winding number sectors, right? But, you know, when SSE and all these other methods first came out, you know, people developed these things as they do research, right? And all people did for a long time was this sort of vague type of local update that I'm talking about. Really what it accounts to is a sort of non-ergodicity in some sense, right? You're not sampling certain parts of your configuration space that you might need. Like if you want to measure superfluid density, which is proportional to winding number squared, you're not going to get that with that type of sampling, right? So a local update, in some sense, you know, works, but it only works in a very generally non-ergodic way. So the trick is that we do basically the exact analogy to the worm update in the SSE, and this is called the operator loop update. Okay, what the operator loop update is it's like breaking this world line that Matthias talked about. And the way it's done in the operator, the way it's done in the SSE is through a sort of two-step abstraction. So I'll just quickly draw out, again, a sort of subset of your simulation cell. It's So here I might have a diagonal operator. Okay, so here I might have an off-diagonal operator, a diagonal operator. And an off-diagonal operator. Well, let's do it the same, let's do the opposite to what I have in my notes. So you have both examples. So here I have three diagonal operators. So it's like I've just finished doing this diagonal update, and I have these operators which don't change any of the basis states. So there's a sort of abstraction which I won't talk about, which is taking this thing and forming what we call a linked list of vertices. So you can imagine each one of these operators in its local basis state, which is really those matrix elements, if you will. You take that out of the simulation cell, and you pack it into another, computational data structure called a linked list. So what that does is that that helps you avoid storing in the SSE the basis state in memory for each propagation step. Can you imagine how much memory it would take if you're at very low temperatures and you're on some big, huge system size? And basically, what you have to store is m copies of this basis and all the operators. It basically, be too much storage. Okay. Really, all you have to do for the diagonal update is keep alpha naught, keep the bottom basis state, and know how the operators propagate the basis, right? So we really have to store the operators themselves and one of the basis states. And by moving to the linked list, we can stay within that sort of efficient representation. And what we do is we take each operator and we represent it as a vertex, okay, which is just its sort of removed disembodied matrix element, if you will. And we connect these things using a pointer structure or some other linked list data structure such that what we call the legs of these vertices connect around all the periodic boundaries in a proper way in the simulation cell. So I mean, you've taken a quantum partition function, you've abstracted it to a D plus one dimensional simulation cell, and then you take that additional thing and you form what's called a linked list, within which we do operator loop updates. This is the single, probably most technically challenging part of coding the SSE, okay? And it's really not that much. It's just a matter of bookkeeping sort of your basis and your operator list and figuring out how you're going to represent that in this efficient method.
So just in your notation, is the top one removing the bond?
So nothing's changed here yet. All I've done is linked up, this link, if you will, follows this basis state up here. But there's no sense in storing this entire basis state. There's no sense in storing this in the computer, right? Because if a diagonal operator is operating here, it's not going to affect this spin, right? And so this one's connecting here, this one's connecting here, this one connects over the periodic boundary, because the boundary here always has to be the same. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to implement this loop move, or this worm algorithm, and I'm going to let it go over the periodic boundaries. So I have to make sure that if it goes over the top, it comes out the bottom, in order that my alpha naught doesn't change. Or else I get a zero contribution, the partition function, the weight of that thing is zero, and then you waste that sampling, right? So see, the updates have to be constructed in a way that they efficiently sample the configuration space. Because you can easily sample a whole bunch of zero weight things, right? But what's the point? So the loop is built by causing a defect, if you will, or causing a worm to have a head, or however the language is you want, and just following that thing through a certain set of rules and flipping all the spins on that closed loop. Okay. So in this case, I've flipped all the spins on here, I've closed the loop up, and my linked list in the end will look like these two flip, right? So it's x0. Oh, I'm flipping them now.
I mean the top one.
What's that? Oh, sorry. Yeah, I'm flipping them. I'm working on it. Okay? Oh, we're going to flip down. See? Sorry, how it looks. Okay, so what's the consequence of this? Okay, this is my new linked list. When you do a whole bunch of these operator loops inside here, and there's rules for how they're done and so on, which really, you have to sit down and go through in order to understand in a way, but what I've done is I sampled now two off-diagonal operators where previously I had no off-diagonal operators, right? So you can see sort of in an abstract way how these operator loop updates give you efficient sampling because they don't disrupt the periodic boundary. They switch between diagonal and off diagonal. You can imagine doing the inverse loop and so on. And they also always give you a non-zero contribution of the partition function. Okay, so the detail in how to implement these loops is really what's the acceptance probability for each step in building that loop. Okay? So inside that operator list, you have a loop going into an operator, x0, well, let's start with all spins down. The update, you know, the thing that you're constructing is going into one of these vertex legs, if you will, and then exiting. And so it can exit either this leg, or this leg, right? So you have to have an update or an acceptance probability for each one of the different, you know, cases there. And that's your Metropolis step, okay? And so that can be fairly complicated. There's some freedom in how you choose those update probabilities. And so I have one example in the notes, which is this heat bath solution, okay? And what I've done is in the notes you can read, I've changed the weights. You know, I've calculated all the weights and so on. And with all the weights of all the vertices, you know, the update, the simplest update you can do is just the one that satisfies Matthias' balance requirement, right? So the probability of going to a configuration weighted by y is just sum of x, wx, p, x to y. And in the operator loop update, because the order of the expansion isn't changing, it's always n, right? So all these statistical prefactors and these factors associated with the expansion, beta the n, they all cancel in ratio of weights. And so the only thing we have to worry about is really the matrix elements. Okay, and each one of those matrix elements, you know, can be represented by that vertex essentially. So like up, up, h, 1b, up, up. Is it same as saying XX, you know, XX? So how many different ways can we exit this vertex if we go into it with a loop, right? There's only three different allowed exits in the XXZ Hamiltonian. Because you can go through and change both of these to an X. You can go this way and change it to an off-diagonal operator. But what you can't do is have this loop turn around and give yourself a vertex which looks like that. That, you know, that's like having an S plus operator, or an S minus operator in your Hamiltonian. Okay, so the allowed weights depend on basically the Hamiltonian. Okay, so you can take that balance condition as homework, because I know you guys are all doing homework, and derive that the probability for update that I have on page 8. Okay, and that's really one of the other problems in the SSE is how to get efficient off-diagonal probabilities or off-diagonal update probabilities. Okay, so I have several possibilities listed there. This one P that I have there that has the three matrix elements on the bottom. That's a heat bath solution. That's the one that follows directly from here. Okay, so we can derive that really easily. But you can have generalizations, and the generalizations are basically done to eliminate the loops bouncing out from the same leg that they came in. Okay, so directed loops and generalized directed loops are the SSE equivalent to these highly efficient loop operator updates that you've heard about already. And you can look for the directed loop probabilities in the initial reading that I gave on the front. So quantum Monte Carlo directed loops, as the name implies, you know, derives a lot of these probabilities. So I'm not going to go too far over because we started a bit late, but I don't want to run late. this really is the sort of philosophical, if you will, construction of the SSE. You have the basis, and you have the operator list, which gives you the configurations, and you have two types of updates now, diagonal updates, and these off-diagonal updates, which are related in a way to what we did in continuous world line methods. In some models, you need other updates, okay? Ring exchange models, even these things can be non-ergodic. Okay, in that case, you don't have bond operators, you have four-site Plaquette operators, six-site Plaquette operators. We have to do Wolf or Swenson-Wang type cluster updates, okay? So you can just imagine that, you know, the type of update you're doing can depend highly on sort of what you're sampling, what you're trying to achieve by doing the Monte Carlo. At very high temperatures also, what you do is you still have an expansion, but you have very few operators in this list, right? So you can get a string of spins that look like this here that are never affected by an operator in your entire expansion list, right? So this string of unaffected spins or basis spins can be flipped with probability 1/2, okay? That obeys detailed balance. So you can see I've given you an idea of a couple updates, but there's sort of an infinite amount of possibilities in principle if you're looking at different models, okay? So just keep it in mind.
How do you satisfy detailed balance if it's the update scheme is not ergodic?
So detailed balance and ergodicity are general different things, I guess. I mean, I think the statement is you can have an update which satisfies detailed balance, but which does not satisfy ergodicity. Okay.
Well, you have zero probability for some configuration.
You have zero probability to go into those configurations,
yeah.
Right? And so you never sample them. Okay. And so that's what's meant by you have this whole part of configuration space, which in some sense you're not sampling, right? It's because of that zero sort of probability. Okay, so I have a list of things that you can measure in the SSE, right? This is the third part. Like, now that you have this whole thing running, what do? You don't just let it run, right? You have to do measurements in the thing. And so in the SSE, the measurements... they depend, again, on how you've broken up the Hamiltonian, okay? It depends on what's diagonal, so what basis you've chosen, and they depend on the bond operator, so they depend on the breakup of the operators in your, I guess, operator list scheme, okay? So anything that's diagonal in the basis, you can essentially measure with some ease, right? So in the notes I have, you know, correlation functions, you know, two-point correlation functions for the SZ components of the spins. So your diagonal in the basis SZ, and so it makes sense that you can somehow just walk through your time slices here, look at the SC configuration, and calculate the correlation function associated with the SC. Right, so that's basis dependent. Right, if you're in the SX basis, or if that's your quantization axis, you'll get a different correlation function, of course. You can measure all these expectation values of operators, so type, if you will. And these things are simply the number of those operators that occur in your expansion list over beta. Okay, so in this case, if you want to measure the expectation value of SX, say, which is, you know, the order parameter for an XY model at zero temperature, you're not going to be able to do that because you're not diagonal on this basis, and you don't have a single SX operator in an XY model, okay? So you have to recode your code into a different basis in order to do stuff like this. So this includes, you know, the expectation value of Hamiltonian itself, which just is a total number of operators. You can also measure correlation functions between any operators that occur in your Hamiltonian, so bond-bond, for example, which I have in the notes. Okay, and this is proportional to n minus 1 number of bond A and B, or something like that. So this B that I've written here, for example, could be, you know, S plus, S minus, plus S minus, S plus, on a bond associated with A. You can do other things. You can do, most importantly, the winding number, which is, you know, how the particle world line winds around the periodic boundaries of the simulation cell. And the winding number squared is equal to your superfluid density, which is one of the more important things in measuring models like Heisenberg model and XOC. Okay, so I won't go into driving the measurements much. They're all in the literature. The final thing I have in my notes is really only the most important restriction on all of this, right? And the most important restriction is this sine problem. So I showed you how the sine problem was eliminated in a diagonal weight. And I didn't explicitly derive the weights associated with the loop updates, but if you look back in the notes, you'll see that the sine problem there explicitly cancels because you have a minus 1 to the n, and you have this product of, n, if you will, matrix elements, right? Alpha, H, alpha. So this is in the loop update, right? So if we're not changing the expansion direction, what we have is we have a minus 1 sign associated with each matrix element. And we force those matrix elements to be negative. The off-diagonal one is minus a half. And the other ones we added this constant to so that they're minus something or they're zero, right? But see, what happens is you get problems when you have Hamiltonians that have a plus sign, for example, in front of the off-diagonal term. Okay, so what about these ones? So this is the difficult sign problem in the SSE. Because what happens is in this expansion, okay, your diagonal operators, well, you've gotten rid of the minus, or you've made them all minus here. And so each n associated with the minus sign for the diagonal operators cancels the minus sign here, everything's fine. But the off-diagonal operators, that's not true. Okay, so you can have all these uncancelled minus signs associated with the positive matrix elements here. So there's two ways around that. And actually, the simplest way is that we force somehow this number n to be even, right? So n2, which means the number of off-diagonal operators, which occurs in the expansion, is even. And then this minus 1 sign cancels. This is why you can do the anti-ferromagnetic Heisenberg model on a square lattice, or any bipartite lattice. Because on a square lattice, if you're looking in this expansion direction, and you're flipping a spin, or say you're hopping a boson around this lattice, it either has to hop once and then back, or 1, 2, 3, 4, and then back. So it's always an even number of off-diagonal operators in order that your alpha naught goes back to alpha naught at the top of your expansion. Okay? And that's why the sine problem doesn't exist for, that's why we can do Heisenberg model, anti-ferromagnetic Heisenberg model, honeycomb or a square or anything like that. Okay, so the problem comes in the SSE, just like it comes in everywhere else, when this number doesn't have to be even, okay? So the prototypical case is the triangular lattice, right? So you can either have a hop and then a hop back, which is even, which is fine. But just the fact that you can have an odd number of hops means that you will sample that world line, right? You will sample that world line that does three hops around the lattice to get you back to its original place. And then you'll have three minus signs, so you have an uncancelled minus sign associated with that weight. Okay? And that sign problem is essentially unsolvable, right? So I got all ambitious and wrote the word theorem. If a path can be found through the lattice that takes an odd number of hops in this picture, then you will have the sign problem. Now there is cases where you can do a clever basis rotation. And some of these ring exchange models, we found basis rotations that get rid of this minus sign. But in general, the basis rotation, if you will, that gets rid of this odd hopping minus sign, of course, has never been found. So I wrote it as a theorem for you guys to prove or disprove by finding somehow a basis rotation that solves this. And that will be the famous solution of the sine problem that will get someone in this room a Nobel Prize. Think of you back there. Okay. So that's all I'm really going to say about the SSE. If you want to talk with me about it, I'm here until the end of the week, okay? So we can go into more details. But I think it's lunchtime now, right? So thank you.